I was asked to present the best arguments against evolution. I was told initially it would take an hour. I've been told that it will actually take a half an hour. We're going to try to keep to the latter figure, but I don't know how much I can compact this. We'll see. Rather than presenting the best arguments against evolution, what I'm going to try to do is to present the best arguments for the traditional belief in creation, for what I gather is largely a scientific skeptical audience. They're not necessarily the best arguments. They're not even necessarily the best arguments for all audiences. I am human and can fail like the rest of you. And the selection is opportunistic to say the least. But we're going to try to make a reasonable case for creation. I view evolution as in the change of life from its original form to the forms that we see today as an integrated part of a larger project, which is sometimes called evolution as well, with a capital E, which explains the universe without reference to any kind of intelligent creator. There are multiple divergences between that project and the traditional Adventist view, but I see the most theologically significant questions as, number one, can the origin of life be explained without reference to intelligence? And number two, how long has life been on this earth? Now, there are a lot of other questions that could be answered. For example, does a finite universe argue for a creator? Does quantum mechanics argue against materialism? Can one adequately account for the variety of life on this earth without reference to intelligence? That is evolution itself true? We will touch on that very briefly, but that won't be the concentration that we will make here. Is there a clear delineation between apes and humans? From whence did consciousness come, and can it be explained by material effects only? And there are even questions such as, how old is the solar system, and how old is the universe? But in my opinion, none of those, except maybe number five, gets to the root of the disagreement. And when one has a short time to go over a lot of evidence, they should probably be left on the cutting floor, at least for a first presentation. So, getting to our questions. Number one, can the origin of life be explained without reference to intelligence? And before I go on, I'm going to kind of ask to get a sense for where the audience is here. Number one, how many of you can say comfortably, there is a God? Not most. Okay? How many of you can say, can God intervene in nature? Now, I will have to say that that's a little tougher question. And in some people's theology, in fact mine, God doesn't actually intervene, he simply does things differently. But in any case, I think you know what I'm talking about. And finally, can we detect with reasonable reliability some of that intervention? Few less. So I'm going to start with the first part of this because it looks like we have a few people that need at least to look at the evidence in that area. So let me get started. The first thing I'm going to say is the design in general can be reliably detected, at least sometimes. Not always, as we will see, but sometimes it is pretty easy and reliably detected. The principles of design detection, I'm just stating this as my opinion on it, but you guys are welcome to disagree. And if you disagree, I suggest that you take notes, and during the question period, we can come back to those questions. The principles of design detection are, number one, it looks designed. It looks like the kinds of things that people design, or for that matter, other animals' design. Beaver dams are designed. Number two, chance, law, or any combination thereof cannot reasonably account for the object. That is, the other alternatives fail. Now, I say reasonably because, yeah, chance can account for anything if you stretch it far enough. But, you know, when you're talking about 10 to the 10 to the 123rd power, I think we can safely ignore the alternative. Okay, now, I'm going to demonstrate to you that you all can detect design. Here are three sets of coins. The heads of the coin are white, and the tails of the coins are black. This is actually done by flipping coins, at least in one instance. They were done by flipping coins and then recording the heads and tails. So, is number one reasonably accounted for by chance, or for that matter, by law? Or is that design? Okay, number two. What do you think of that one? Is that design? Is that chance? Is that law? Okay, and now number three. Is that chance, design, or law? How many of you think that number three is due to chance? No takers. How many of you think that it's due to law? No takers. I guess we're pretty unanimous that that's due to a design, a deliberate design of somebody. Now, what do you think about the following arguments, which are all used in these kinds of instances? One, all three have heads, tails, ratios statistically close to 0.5, and some must be random. No? What about a non-random pattern can be misinterpreted as random, and therefore a random pattern can be misinterpreted as non-random, and the method fails? No? What about there was no prior hypothesis by you design detectors, therefore your detection is invalid? Any pattern is equally valid, so they're all likely to be random. These are all your arguments I've seen in this kind of situation. We can't detect design unless we know how the design was made. Do any of you know exactly how that design was made? We can't detect design unless we know who the designer was. No? Number three can't be designed because it has an imperfection. Nobody's buying that. What about number three can't be designed? Because if it's not designed, it's not designed. And if it's designed, it says it's due to chance, and therefore can't be designed. No? It is a good thing that there are 560 bits in each design, because only half that amount of bits could not reasonably indicate design. No takers. Okay? So we can detect design. Furthermore, I'm going to show you that you missed a design. Okay, let's take binary pi. This is just straight from a website. We're going to cut out the first 560 digits. Okay. We're going to paste them in. We're going to take out the period, the 256 and the 512 there. And we're going to line them up in rows of 35. Now what we're going to do is we're going to put spaces between all the ones that don't have them. So we get a nice square, well, not square, but rectangular array. And now what we're going to do is we're going to slide that number 2 behind it. And as we do so, you will notice that all of the zeros show up. There is one mistake. right there, where there should be a zero and there's a one. Okay? Now, let's change the print in the front from white to black. And when you do that, you will notice that all of the ones are on white spaces. Now, after seeing that, how many of you think that number two was due to chance alone? No takers. So design can be detected, and it can be detected reliably. Now, I won't go into why, although that would be an interesting subject, but having established that design detection is possible, then I want to point out that some things that look designed and have no current or reasonably anticipated natural explanation reasonably require godlike intelligence to explain them. Godlike intelligence being intelligence that is like ours, only way better. And one of them is the origin of life. Now, the classic work on that, I think, is Signature in the Cell by Stephen Meyer. But I'm going to go to a different source right now, namely Eugene Koonin. In the Cosmological Model of Eternal Inflation and the Transition from Chance to Biological Evolution in the History of Life, from Biology Direct. Those of you who want to can look up the paper. It's published in 2007. It's peer-reviewed literature, and Eugene Koonin is, let's just say, not exactly a creationist. And I'm going to excerpt a few sentences from that paper. It is clear that the origin of replication and transcription is not just the hardest problem in all of evolutionary biology, but one that is qualitatively distinct from the rest. For all other problems, the basis of biological evolution, genome replication, is in place. But in the case of OORT, the emergence of this mechanism itself is what is to be explained. Despite considerable experimental and theoretical effort, no compelling scenarios currently exist for the origin of replication and translation. Those are from two different paragraphs, by the way. There's another one that I'll quote, and it gives his solution. Even in this toy model, which he has outlined, basically allowing for RNA reproduction in incredible amounts, the probability that a coupled translation replication emerges by chance in a single O region, that is, a region of the universe that we can see, is 10 to the minus 1018. Obviously, this version of the breakthrough stage can be considered only in the context of a universe with an infinite, or in the very least, extremely vast number of O regions. How much vast? It's like having one universe for every particle in this known universe, and doing that about 900 times. That's the kind of numbers we're talking about. Now, again, coming back to our original thesis, the origin of life, the case is made very well by Signature in the Cell by Stephen Meyer. The Cambrian explosion is also done very well by Darwin's Doubt by Stephen Meyer. Although there are other, there's other literature that you can read about it if you want to. And the origin of new proteins has been fairly definitively studied by the book Undeniable by Douglas Axe and the references that are found therein, some of which were actually published by Douglas Axe, again, in the peer-reviewed literature. Now, let us concede then, hypothetically, just for the moment, that design is detectable and that design divine design has been detected, which doesn't seem like too much of a stretch from what we've just seen. The inevitable conclusion is, among other things, that the current scientific consensus, what some people call science, is wrong, and in a theologically significant way. There is no reason why they cannot be wrong in other theologically significant ways. Furthermore, we cannot appeal to a universe without miracles to squash any reports of miracles, because that hypothesis has already been disproven. In fact, when reconstructing history with claimed miracles, theology, namely what God would do, becomes much more important than science, what nature can do on its own, or at least what God usually does, if you want to phrase it that way. That means also that science is no defense against the resurrection. And finally, that reliable eyewitness accounts become more important in determining history than scientific reasoning. Now that's backwards from what many of us as scientists have been taught for a long time. Now, we come to the question two, how long has life been on this earth? Okay, now, a few words. My answer is not exhaustive. I will break it into two parts. Theological, which is the more important one, as I have just outlined, theology becomes more important than science. And also, scientific, what scientists usually think is more important. And I'm going to say that if we have a God and if he has intervened, then we basically boil down to three choices. One, God front-loaded the information, or perhaps guided in evolution, or perhaps flat-out interfered with miracles that you can see easily, or maybe a bit of all three. And the current standard geologic timescale is roughly accurate. Number two, the devil used evolution to create during a standard geologic timescale, and then God either recreated or took over the devil's creation. And that will be a problem for that. We'll discuss that. And the third option is that life, that God created life substantially as recorded in Genesis 1 and 2, with a fall recorded in Genesis 3. And for what it's worth, the flood in 6 through 9. Now, first, for the biblical evidence, which I think is important, but your mileage may vary. The account was clearly intended to be literal, as admitted by virtually all scholars that don't have a dog in the hunt. Basil gave a whole series of sermons on the 6 days of creation, and they're clearly literal to him. The near universal witness of the church is the same way. They don't always deal with it in the same depth as Basil does, but they clearly view it as being literal. And that, by the way, includes Michelangelo, whose painting you may recognize as the background for this slide. The only exceptions that I can find are Origen, who needs no further comment, and Augustine. And, of course, Protestants are very respectful of Augustine. Augustine's arguments were, interestingly, for an instantaneous creation rather than one in 6 days, and he has three major points he makes in coming to that conclusion. Number one, the biblical argument was based on Ecclesiasticus. If you haven't heard of that, that's in the Apocrypha. Sirach 18:1, which reads, in the old King James, "He that liveth forever hath created all things in general." Now, in Augustine's Latin Bible, the last word read simul, or simultaneously. This actually turned out to be a poor translation of the original Greek, which read koine, which is pretty well translated by the King James Version in general. Augustine's philosophical argument was that a creation that took time would not be perfect because the stages are imperfect, and implied intermediate imperfect steps, and this would be unworthy of a perfect God. You may not like that argument, but that's the one he made. Augustine's scientific argument was that it made no sense for light to travel around the world before the sun was created. Augustine believed in a round world, as did most of his contemporaries, and as did most Christians, including Basil, for what it's worth. But he couldn't see light going around the world. Now, those arguments don't work today. First of all, the biblical argument is on the basis of a poor translation of an apocryphal verse. That's not really valid. The philosophical necessity of an instantaneously perfect creation is by no means obvious. Seems to be contradicted by the Bible that talks about things being good and good and good, and when God finished, it was very good. And finally, light no longer has to travel around the world for the first 3 days. All it has to do is be unidirectional. That is, the earth turns and the light just keeps coming from the same direction. Now, it's interesting that Augustine made his mistake in interpretation on the basis of philosophy and the science of the day. This might be a cautionary tale for our time. But in any case, I think it's fair to say that if you think that the biblical account has any weight, that weight supports a recent creation. Now, for theological considerations, there is the question of death before sin. Remember that in Romans 5, although through one man's sin, death passed upon all for all of sin, clear allusion to Adam, he uses the term elsewhere in Romans. And that the wages of sin is death. In old divine creation, that is, God did it somehow over billions of years, death, including predation and disease, occurred before any reasonable interpretation of the time of Adam. Now, one can claim that hominids were not truly human, and those other animals weren't really human, and what he's talking about is human death. But the biblical writers do seem concerned about nature as well as about humankind. For example, Romans 8:19-23, the creation itself is involved in the fall and will be redeemed along with us. In Matthew 10:29-31, God pays attention to the death of sparrows. And in Isaiah 11 and Isaiah 65, animal death does not appear to be part of the new earth, raising the question of whether it was part of God's original creation. Then there's the problem of natural evil. Now, the problem of human-caused evil is usually solved by using the free will defense, which is that love requires free will, and the free will requires at least the possibility of some people choosing wrongly, and their choices having consequences. However, natural evil, that is death by volcanic eruption, tsunami, flood, drought, cancer, is not explained by this argument. Old divine creation is a model that's vulnerable at this point. On the other hand, a recent creation model can escape this criticism because in this model, major tectonic plate movement was not present in Eden, implying no volcanoes, no major earthquakes, no tsunamis during that time. And with a fairly uniform, mild, rainless climate, hurricanes, tornadoes, floods, and probably droughts would be non-existent. In addition, the tree of life might be something that would prevent, among other things, cancer. The leaves apparently having healing powers according to Revelation 22. Now, old demonic creation escapes those problems, but it has its own theological problems. First of all, it comes close to duplicating the old Gnostic idea that a lesser God created the material universe, or at least the living creatures in our part of it. But in addition to that, there's the problem of the relationship of the demonic to the divine creation. Did God recreate everything, including ginkgo trees, coelacanths, and horseshoe crabs that are found in the fossil record and also today? In that case, why did he use the devil's models? Or are perhaps all animals that can be dated over 50,000 years ago actually demonic creations? Ginkgos are demonic. And not very good, as Genesis 1 seems to imply. There's the question of the relationship of man to hominids. Did some hominids survive after Adam, and some humans have more or less demon-created blood in them? Or did all the hominids besides humans get killed off, in which case, why do we look so much like previous hominids? Before you get excited about the racial aspect of this thing, let me remind you that Europeans in general have more Neanderthal blood in them than do blacks. I think there is some strain in that kind of theory. Not saying that it makes it fail, but it does make it theologically a little less attractive. The problem, of course, does not exist with either old divine creation or recent creation. So at least in my opinion, recent creation is the most defensible theologically. Now there are scientific considerations. I'm going to list them. Mostly I'm going to deal with positive ones rather than negative ones, ones that indicate a short age rather than ones that defend a short age against long age accusations. I'm going to start with paraconformities, and that's especially true if you have soft sediment deformation. There are erosion rates, especially in Mount Everest and the Alps. There's polystrate fossils, which by themselves aren't a great argument, but put with paraconformities, are. There are paleocurrents. There's soft tissues in dinosaurs and ancient life. There's carbon-14 and beryllium-10 in ancient material. There's helium that's still in uranium minerals. And finally, there's genetic entropy. These are obviously not exhaustive, but they give you a flavor. Now, I've taken, I think, about 25 minutes at this point, and I will ask how much further we want to go.
How much more material?
I have enough material that if I wanted to, I could cover probably another 25 minutes. If you'd rather, sure. We can just do the first one or two and then stop there.
Let's do it.
So, paraconformities. First, I need to introduce to you what a conformity is and an unconformity, and then a paraconformity. Here's an unconformity in the Grand Canyon. It's the lower arrow is unconformity between sediments and the Vishnu schist. The upper arrow here is an unconformity between the Tapeat sandstone and everything below it. It continues on over here, and you can see the layers coming up to it and kind of being shaved off. Okay, that's an unconformity. Now, if you look up here, you see all these layers that are laying on top of each other as if they were stacked. Those are mostly conformities. Can anybody find a paraconformity in there? Well, let me help you. There's one right at the base of the Coconino sandstone. The hermit shale sits on top of it, and it looks like it belongs there. But there is a gap of about 6 million years. You can see it also in the background there. Okay? How do we know that's a paraconformity instead of a regular conformity? Because if you go to Sedona, Arizona, you will find between the Coconino sandstone and the Hermit Shale another formation. It's called the Schnibbly Hill Formation. I think it's with an S, but I could be wrong on that. See, whereas up here, the Schnibbly Hill Formation is not there. That's what looks like a conformity, but it's really not. And that's why it's called a paraconformity. Now the question is, what happened during those 6 million years? Well, that turns out not to be an isolated event. There's our 6 million year, but there's another 14 million years here. And there's another 100 million years here. Lest you think this is all only in the Grand Canyon, Well, before we do that, you notice the pair conformities here. Here's the conformities. And here's what you expect when there's a pair conformity. There's erosion. And it's not going to be all even all the way across. And so you have some areas that are low, and they'll be filled in later. And by the time you fill in the last layer, you have a very complex layering. But in the Grand Canyon, you don't see that. But you know that between layers 2 and 3, there is geologic time, because away over here, layers A and B, in the case of the Snively Hills, it's only layer A, but it's the same principle. Layer A is there, and you know it used to be there in the other place, and either it never got deposited, in which case the rock just sat there for millions of years without being eroded and without being deposited on, or something came and washed it off. So how much erosion are you expecting during that time frame? Well, people have figured out how much erosion you normally would have during that time period. And in the case of the 6 million years, you are talking about 600 feet. In the middle one, you're talking about twice that. And in the bottom one, you are talking 3 kilometers, or roughly 2 miles. That is a lot of erosion. The Grand Canyon itself isn't 2 miles deep. These things are all over the place. Here at Santa Monica, you have 20 million years here, 10 million years here. 20 million years here, you know, 10 million here, 20 million there. Pretty soon you're talking about real time. You have 40 million years here. Lest you think this is all a phenomenon in the United States, there's the Swiss Alps, and there's 40 million years missing. Just gone. And in fact, in this case, the upper layers are the older layers, and the younger layers are the lower layers. It's been flipped. In New Zealand, there's only 3 million years missing there. How much erosion do you expect in 3 million years? Do you expect it to be quite that flat? Here is in Australia, 6 million years missing from on top of that coal. How do you let coal sit out there for 6 million years without eroding away? It happened. Maybe it wasn't 6 million years. And it does add up to hundreds of millions of years. Here's 190 million years in the petrified forest in Arizona. And in Texas, we have 200 million years between some very flat layers. And it's 16 million years thrown in for fun. Now, here's one that's a measly 10 million years old. And you're thinking, well, maybe what happened is the bottom layer got really hard, stacked mud on top of it, the mud got washed off, and then we wound up with the top layer coming on over a newly cleaned lower layer. The problem with that theory in this particular case is that in Capitol Reef, you actually have the top layer of that 10 million year gap, the Shinarum conglomerate, coming in and laying over on top the Mohn Kopi. But you will notice that Mohn Kopi has oozed up into the Shinarum, that Shinarum has oozed down into the Mohn Kopi, and that a big piece of Shinarum has just nicely smoothed down. You're trying to tell me that the thing was sitting there for 10 million years, excuse me, and it never eroded, but it was soft enough that when the overlying layer came across it, all that stuff sunk down. That's really hard to believe. Okay, what about erosion? In Mount Everest and the Alps, we have Mount Everest has been rising between 10 and 55 million years. depends on who you read. I think that I saw one that was 8. It's been rising between 4 millimeters and 61 millimeters per year. And again, it depends on who you read. It's been eroding at about 2.1 millimeters per year. And it's interesting to take that and play with it. This is the entire height of Mount Everest, 8,850 meters. If you divide that by 2.1 millimeters a year, that means you can raise it from sea level to the top in 4 million years, 4.2. If you have 10 million years, you can raise it 21 kilometers. That's how much stuff should be eroded off the top of Mount Everest. Well, maybe it wasn't quite that fast initially. So maybe it's 10 kilometers instead of 21. 10 kilometers is higher than the height of Mount Everest by a good stretch. Okay? Now, it's been raising for 4.1 million minus millimeters per year, minus 2.1 millimeters, or 1.9 million meters per year. And that means that the entire mountain can have come out, including erosion, in 4,700 years. Now you can see why people have been abandoning the 55 million year theory, even though it's the otherwise better supported theory. How do you get Mount Everest to not be, you know, 5 miles, 6 miles, 8 miles high? And so then, what if it's eroding with the larger number? Now you're talking 145,000 years. And the larger number, by the way, happens to be the best estimate from GPS. Now, one could understand this kind of erosion, and maybe they just balanced each other out, and we'll just take the lower number, and we're off by a factor of 2 somewhere. And if the mountain were made out of solid granite, because you can keep pushing up the granite from below. But the top of Mount Everest, which I should credit to some people who loaned me the photo, actually is not made out of granite, it's made out of Ordovician limestone. That's right, the cap of that thing still has fossils in it. Why wasn't that eroded away? Another shot where you can see it a little better. Again, courtesy of Mountains of Travel Photos. Look at that. You can see the layers on top of it. And then the schist and the gneiss and all that stuff, granite, is all below that. Polystrate fossils are a small problem. They are a major problem to the theory that everything accumulated over millions of years, but they don't span the fossil record, so you can theorize a flood if you want to. They do tie at least that one little aspect together as a part of a rapid deposit. And they suggest that the fossil record is deposited in large units, as Derek Avery would have it, instead of Charles Lyell.
Well, I think you're making a lot of assumptions with a lot of people don't know what conformity means. And here you're talking all about this paraconformity. You need to explain the simple things first, because a lot of people don't know what conformity is. So you're going on and on about things that most of us here, I mean, I know it, but people who don't study geology, they don't know what conformity means. So you need to explain some of these simpler things before you go off into numbers. And so, you know, I think it would be helpful if you got some basic information to the audience here.
I apologize. I thought I had started with the definition of conformity and paraconformity and unconformity, but
I don't think it
apparently
came across.
I didn't make it clear enough to you. So,
Paul, can you define polystrate? I know what
polystrate means multiple strata, and I'm going to show you a photo that will perfectly illustrate that in just a minute. Okay. Now, if this whole thing is buried in units rather than like little bits at a time, as in the Lyellian model, then what that means is that you have a unit, then you have time in between, and then you have another unit. And now all of a sudden, where what used to be conformities are actually small paraconformities as well. That is to say, the unit was deposited, and then 6 million years later, the next unit is deposited, and in between them, you have a gap of 6 million years. So the arguments that we were talking about with paraconformities suddenly are valid throughout the entire geologic record. And here's an example of a polystrate fossil. This tree trunk goes right through. You can see the people for scale. It's not isolated. If you look over here, here's another one. Here's one that's at 40 degrees. How do you get something like that sitting for thousands or millions of years, unsupported, and then finally the strata comes up and fills it up? This looks deposited all at once. And again, it does not prove a short time frame, but what it does suggest is that the Lyellian model does not work. Paleocurrents are interesting. Modern and Precambrian currents are more or less scattered, but during the Phanerozoic, that is during the time when creation is traditionally assigned to the flood, there's high directionality, which reverses itself during the Mesozoic, and I'm going to show you that. It's suggestive of a continent-wide flood, and in fact, if you put it together with where the other continents are, it's suggestive of a worldwide flood. Modern paleocurrents go in all different directions. Precambrian paleocurrents are probably more east to west than anything else, but there are significant exceptions. When you get to the Cambrian, suddenly everything organizes. Here's all of these things are going west to southwest. That scatter that you saw before just doesn't occur. It continues through, this is a Pennsylvanian. It continues through the Triassic. And then in the Jurassic, there's dramatic switch, especially in the western United States, where now the currents are going in the opposite direction. That's not the behavior you expect from drainage patterns. That's more of the behavior you expect from a flood. What about soft tissues in dinosaurs in ancient life? Those of you who are familiar with Mary Schweitzer's work know that things that look an awful lot like blood vessels that have what look an awful lot like reptilian blood cells or bird blood cells are found in material that's supposed to be 65, 69, 70 million years old. And there's now a report out that you can find them in 190 million year old stuff. How does it last that long? There have been confirmatory efforts showing that, in fact, these things really do happen. There are bacteria that whose spores can be reawakened after 250 million years. Is it really that old? These kinds of things were not expected by believers in long ages. In fact, Mary Schweitzer herself stumbled on this, as she put it, since she was too stupid to realize that it couldn't be there. Carbon-14 and beryllium has been found in ancient material. Carbon-14 can be found in coal, it can be found in dinosaur bone, it can be found in all kinds of places. If the coal or dinosaur bone is over 1 million years old, it shouldn't be there. People who want to argue for long ages are kind of left with arguing for either it being created by neutrons or some kind of contamination of the specimen in the ground or some kind of contamination in the lab. Basically, what they have to say is that data is not reliable. It's an interesting stance to take. And beryllium-10 presents a very similar problem. don't have time to go into either one of those. They could take probably 15 to 30 minutes at least to present that. Helium is still in uranium minerals. Again, I'm going to go, you know, we're going fast. It was first noted by Robert Gentry, is quantified by the Rate Group, and the data matches the recent creation predictions, and it's off some five orders of magnitude from that which would be predicted by long-age advocates. And here is the data itself. Diffusivity measured in centimeters squared per second. This is a log scale, so this is huge differences. You will notice that it has nice, by the time you do that, with the inverse temperature. There are thermodynamic reasons for that. Don't worry about them at this point unless you're familiar with them. But you have this nice little curve that matches the creation model fairly well. The uniformitarian model fails it rather badly. And the final one I'll mention is the genetic entropy. We're each born with some 120 new mutations. Most of these are mildly deleterious, but they're not so bad as to be visible significantly to natural selection. Yeah, and each of our kids gets 120 new ones. Well, maybe 60, maybe 180, maybe, you know, that's an average, and it probably depends on what you eat and all that stuff. But these mutations can't be selected against, and that means that we are slowly devolving. And that's one that a lot of people might want to argue with, but in fact, you can show that from the literature, we are devolving. It is highly unlikely that a genome could survive with the mass for a million years. And that is what drove John Sanford, who is a world-recognized authority, inventor of the gene gun, among other things, still sharp. He's now a recent creationist. It's not all the drugging, but it's a major part of the drugging. This is no way exhaustive list. We haven't done any defensive stuff. Yellowstone fossil forest, the Coconino footprints. We haven't discussed the human Y chromosome. We haven't discussed amino acid dating. We haven't talked about Lyell's attempt to free the science from Moses or Dean Kenyon or Guillermo Gonzalez or Steve Meyer or Mark Armitage, or other evidence of prejudice against the activity of God in nature. I hope I've left you something to think about, and I hope maybe some other day we can go over some of these subjects in a bit more depth, because we've really whizzed through. But I am now finished, and it's now your turn.
Take down names just a reminder to those who are not regulars here. We make a list of 3-minute comments or questions, and we will go in the order in which I write them down. The exception is that those commenters who specifically want to address the topic that is being discussed and not change the subject, you can request a 1-minute comment, provided you stay on subject and not change it. Okay, let me take names. John?
No, not this John anyway. I pointed at Irv.
And Paul?
Irv.
No, Bill.
Let me write down some numbers here first. Okay, is that George? Oh, Keith. Did you get Malin? T. Joe. Malin, I think.
The young
man. Malin, Gary, Dennis.
Connie?
Bonnie.
Did you put him in
the Yes, sir. Okay. Over there, it's
Tejo.
Joe and
Doug. Douglas.
You know, I can't, the dark can't see. Douglas is asking to get a heart.
Yeah, cataracts, did it?
It's good to talk to all of us.
Joe and
Carl.
Barbara. I've got 10 names so far, so it's like we have.
So did you get Doug?
Okay, I got John D, Paul, Keith, Malin, Gary, Bonnie, Irv, Joe, Barbara, Doug.
Did you get Carl?
Carl. Okay, I've got a lot of names to work from. Now make sure, because I got a lot of names here, make sure if you have 1 minute comment, it's on the subject that's already on the floor. Don't change subject. If you want to change subject, get in line and be number 12. Okay, John Buckles.
Hey, Paul, welcome back.
Thank you.
How are you? Paul, there's three things I want to go over. First thing is, my head was going to snap off because you're mixing science and theology as if they're almost interchangeable. And you can come up with pretty much anything you want when you do that. So I want to, how do I detect demonic creation or demonic design versus non-demonic design when I can't even figure out how I detect non-demonic design? Second problem you have, you don't even know what you're talking about when you talk about God. It's a presupposition. And everything in the Bible comes from the mind, the cortex of the human that says this is what God is. And the problem is there's no uniform definition of what this supposed creator, yet you can detect his creation. The other thing that you're doing exactly what Michael Shermer talks about. The unconformity of the Grand Canyon is well known. In fact, I was reading just recently, there's more time missing sometimes than maybe there's time that's actually accounted for. So you're right. So you find this aha moment, and what Michael Shermer talks about, there's a psychological predisposition. If you want to believe, you'll find the aha moment, and you'll say, aha, can't be explained by science. Therefore, the divine explains it. But I would challenge you to tell me how the divine explains these missing gaps. And last but not least, Hawking talks about life is a rare event. So the 1 in 10 to the negative 18th power, it's not impressing me because you have a universe of infinite possibilities. Therefore, you will detect the rare event. And it's problematic. The problem is we can't, our distances are so vast. Just on the basis of statistical uniformity, chances are life being an extremely 1 in 10 to the negative 100th power of existing, you will find it out there because you have an infinite number of possibilities. So my point is that I don't see, you can use what you've done to validate your own personal position, but your arguments can't validate whether there is or isn't a God. I guess that's my frustration because there was times when I want to believe in one, but I can't validate it. And doing what you're doing, mixing arguments and going, aha, therefore there must be God, demonic versus non-demonic design, and then the fact, using these impressive rare numbers, which don't impress me anymore because when I read Hawking's Brief History of Time as well as The Grand Design, he points out that the order is in the disorder and you don't need a God to explain it.
Okay, there's about 4 questions there.
Well, 3. I'm going
Why don't you pick the one you want me to answer the most, and I'll answer it.
Talk about life as a rare event, And that, but under statistical uniformity, you're going to find it, even though it's extremely rare. You don't, and that basically life comes out. That order comes out of the disorder of the universe.
Okay, that's a fair question. Let's ask first of all: is our universe infinite? I think the universe that we can see is not infinite. It has a diameter. It has a beginning. And if you assume the reasonably most liberal explanation of it, there are some 10 to the 80th particles. Okay, it's a cross-section right now. The visible universe that we can see is about supposedly 13.8 billion years old. More or less. And its diameter is limited by how fast things can travel in 13.8 billion years. If you want to count where things are now, probably it's a little bit past that, so it's maybe 50 billion years across, but that's all. But in any case, there are 10 to the 80th particles in the known visible universe.
It doesn't include dark matter.
Now, if you count for dark matter, that only increases it to 10 to the 81 particles, assuming the dark matter is made out of particles, which we don't know. But in any case, those numbers aren't going to change a great deal. There are roughly, I think, about 10 to the 29 seconds since the Big Bang. It would make it 10 to the 30th, so it's 10 times the distance from the Big Bang. You count how fast it takes for a light particle to get past the nucleus, and it's 10 to the minus 43 seconds. And that's as fast as anything can react. So the number of different reactions that can have taken place is 10 to the 80th times 10 to the 43rd times 10 to the 30th, let's say. That is a generous offering for what can physically happen. The numbers that we're talking about are so much larger than that, that to ascribe them to chance makes it ridiculous. And Eugene Koonin pointed that out. He said, in order to make it work, you can't do it with the universe. You have to have a multiverse. And the multiverse has to be, well, if it's let's say 10 to the 200 reactions, or 2 to the 500 if you prefer, then stretching that all throughout, if you're talking 10 to the 1,000, remember that's a low ball estimate.
So, but this argument you're giving me, Paul, that gets you to God?
What it gets me to
because
is
you can't explain something within the framework, therefore there must be God. It's
something,
not logical.
Something planned
you
this.
You can't show me God.
And either that something or something behind it planned this. And you can only go back some 13.8 billion years, and that something must not have its intelligence based upon the order of the organization of matter. It must be extra material. That comes awfully close to calling it supernatural.
Okay.
I mean,
God is
if you want to define
is.
Natures, including all of that stuff, you can. But in that case, your nature is much larger than the standard definition of nature. Now, would I convince somebody who couldn't believe in it? Well, maybe if they went home and thought about it a little bit, I could. I don't know that I can convince people instantly. In fact, maybe that's something that nobody can do instantly.
Malin's got a 1 minute. I'd like to hear what he has.
Okay, Malin.
Those huge numbers that you quote there, that basically assumes a mechanism of all of the necessary particles for a given molecule suddenly coming together in one place and binding, correct? It's assuming a chance encounter of the necessary molecules.
Not really. It could include an encounter here and an encounter there, and you finally wind up with it a million years later.
But how else would you get that number other than by chance, another than them coming together by chance? That's the mechanism. No scientist that I've ever heard of recognizes that as a way of the origin of larger molecules. Those larger molecules clearly, and certainly in our world today, originate in a process, not all at once by all the particles coming together. Those big numbers are a straw man that has no scientific meaning.
Well, tell that to Eugene Cooney.
Well, I would if he was here today.
Okay.
Because that's the model that on which those numbers are based.
And when Eugene Koonin said that, he got accused of giving the intelligent design advocates aid and comfort.
Well, they didn't think about the model. That was the secret.
Here's the thing. In evolution, you can keep the intermediate creatures alive as long as there's no poison going on. When you're talking about the origin of life, you can't keep the intermediate creatures alive because they're not alive.
There are many steps in when we go outside of that argument. I'm just talking about those numbers as being convincing or not convincing. I'm saying that they should not be used because no scientist would imagine that kind of model. That's the only argument I'm making.
Do you know what models the scientists imagine?
Oh, I've read some of the ones that they're thinking about and working on.
They're rather, shall we say, optimistic to believe any of them.
Well, I freely admit that there is no organized theory of the origin of life. At present, people are working on aspects of it. That's right. But neither has it been proved that it cannot be done.
But you know what? You don't prove anything in science. Especially if you're allowing for those kinds of infinitesimal probabilities to have actually happened. There's no proof in science.
Right. Well, again, I only made the point of the meaning of the numbers. That's the only point I wanted to make.
Yeah.
Paul, why don't you make it easy for us here? Explain to us where God came from. Who was he? Who's this intelligent design you're talking about?
Well, the classic theory is he's always been there.
Well, what does that mean? Give us some real...
Let me put it this way.
Like you did with the Grand Canyon, just tell us where God is. Where he is.
I see what your number is.
That would help a lot.
I have a birthday
card. You got a lot of questions to get through.
John 1:1 is the best I can think of.
The thing I find is that question is both invalid in the strict sense. If God has always been there, then where did he come from is a category error. The second one is that it seems rather dumb in that if I am walking the streets of New York and I suddenly see an alligator behind me, my first question is not, where did he come from? My first question is, where's the nearest fire escape? Okay? There are some things that are true whether we understand exactly where they came from or not. And I think that we have to allow that.
Your name is...
Okay, we got to get to make some progress on this list here. Paul Preece, you're number 2.
I have dozens of questions that I can ask, but I'll limit it to one.
Okay.
Genesis 1, flowering plants were created on the third day. Yet, in the Grand Canyon strata, from the bottom to the top of the Grand Canyon, not a single pollen grain of a flowering plant is found. Yet, in the Grand Staircase above the Grand Canyon, they find all kinds of pollen of the flowering plants. How do you explain that discrepancy in your flood model that you were proposing? flowering plants don't appear until the Cretaceous. Yet there was all kinds of life before the Cretaceous.
Well, all kinds but one at least, or all kinds but two, or something like that, yes. And that is a fair question for any kind of a flood model. The best that I can do, because I don't have a highly polished flood model that answers all of those questions, but the best that I can do is make a suggestion, and that is that the world before the flood was organized much differently from the world that we have now, and that you may even have had it set out in kind of a zoo-like thing with certain kinds of animals living in some areas and certain kind of animals living in other areas, and that when the flood came, the flowering plants were in an area that got covered last. Now, there are problems with that theory. I think there are problems with everybody's theory. That particular problem is made a little bit easier if most of the pollination was not done by wind, as in present, but was done by various insects and spiders and whatever else artificially
interrupt you here. But you're talking about an old model of ecological zonation that was put forward by, I think, Clark or possibly Marsh beforehand. But the fact remains is that you don't have pollen in the geological strata of the Grand Canyon. You don't have flowering from there. If there was a flood, then the pollen from the flowering plants should have been intermixed with at least some of that. But it's not. It doesn't appear until the Cretaceous. So what you're giving me as an answer is a whole lot of speculation. You're not giving me science. Okay? And I can't accept what you say a speculation unless you can provide me with evidence that I can grab a hold of and believe in. You want me to believe in creation? Then you're going to have to make the evidence fit the creation model, and it just doesn't.
Well, some of the evidence does fit, but I will agree with you that this particular problem is one that has not been solved, and you know, if one is a skeptical bent, one can say it will never be solved. There are some other problems that I don't know how to fit this, but I don't know how anybody else fits it either. In Venezuela, for example, there's Precambrian pollen. What's it doing there? I have no idea. And, you know, there have been people going back and forth, but it can't be there, but it is there, but it can't be there. And I see these kinds of arguments all the time. I see them in for example, the finding of halobacteria in salt crystals in the Permian, where those organisms can't be there, but they are there, but they can't be there, but they are there. And I think sometimes we just don't have all the answers. And at present, that's one of them.
Okay, Keith, you're number three.
Yeah, thanks for coming to the Lion's Den. that was the sermon Randy gave this morning, too. But anyway, I've been coming to this class for probably about 30-some years, and desperate at first to find reasons for believing in a God, you know. And realizing finally after years of doing this that it's a faith issue, not one that I'm going to be able to prove scientifically. I admire you for trying to do that, and the group of people that do work on intelligent design, this sort of thing, but yet it still boils down to a faith issue to me. But I was interested, I don't know if you're, you probably are aware of Hugh Ross's theories about this, and what do you think about his way of looking at the creator and the creation that that Adam and Eve were dropped in the middle of millions of years of, of evolution that's gone on. So have you considered
That's a good question. As you noticed, I did point out that there are theological problems with that. But
the theology is quite
I know. And we usually think of theology as being much less precise than science, and science being able to prove much more than theology. The truth of the matter is where I come down is partly due to my own personal history. That is that I took one of these things way back in 1979 when I became aware that there was a new form of carbon-14 dating. And I saw the possibility, not the known probability, but the possibility that one might be able to find carbon-14 in ancient material. And so from that, I have kind of pursued it. And as I pursued it, I found that the more I looked at it, the more it looked like it really belonged there. Now, after seeing that, after seeing what the origin of life was, which was my study in my senior year in college, and after seeing a number of other a number of other subjects trending in the direction of short age, I felt that I was confident not only that short age belonged there, but that it could be not proved, but perhaps better yet, indicated. Now, you know, other people with different experiences probably would see things differently. And you're right that in the end, it does come down to faith, because even if you look at those statistics, you can always say, but it happened, so it must have happened somehow without any intervention of any intelligent being. You can do that, you know? But it, to a certain extent, to me, at a certain point, it comes down to, do I really believe that Arnold won the lottery 6 times and it wasn't due to his nephew running the show? And I go to myself, no, I can't buy that. And 6 times is a minimum figure for some of these numbers. You know, if, let's put it this way, if Trump wins Powerball, it won't take me 3 times in a row to figure out something is wrong. Okay? At some point, it seems to me you have to kind of let go of those kinds of weird possibilities. Unless you have to have faith that there's no God.
Okay, let's go to the next. Maylin, you're next, number 4.
I would just like to talk about one issue, and that is it possible to detect when there is an interference in nature? And I think you made your point is that it is possible that one can make that detection. I'd like to argue against that on 2 grounds. One, in the history of science, people have a number of times decided that they could make that decision. Finding a clock, stumbling upon a clock, for example, and seeing design. intelligent design movement itself, and so on. I think in the history of science, we find that each one of those, including intelligent design, by the way, has been proved to be untrue. That is, it is not a proof of the breaking of known laws of science, but rather our ignorance of how to apply them. Things that we do today would seem very supernatural to the people of 100 years ago, and I don't know any reason why 100 years from now the things we do today and attribute to miracles would also be considered natural. So I think the evidence is against the idea of proving that something is supernatural. And that's the step. I don't argue with the intelligent design people in defining design. Sure, design occurs. But the next step in that intelligent design argument is, therefore, it had to be a supernatural intervention in natural law. That's the step that I have problems with. Because it's very clear that design can originate by natural processes, including change of genetics, as well as crystals and various other forms of design. So I think there's a problem with proving that something is outside of the world of nature. I happen to be a theoretician in the sense of looking at mathematical models of how complex things are put together and how they work. And one of the ideas that comes out of that is that you do not know the limits when you start building something that's more complex. You do not know the limits of what that thing, that system can do. You can only explore and find what can be done, but you never, the possibilities are so infinite that you never know the limits. That's a mathematical and theoretical fact.
Well, you can look at it that way if you want to. I see that there's clear evidence of design. If somebody were to tell me that it was aliens, I don't have a good defense against that. The only question that I would have is, and here's where the question about the origin is fair, where do those aliens come from? And it, unless you want to assume somewhere an origin of life spontaneously, then you get back to the beginning of time for this universe and you reach a wall where the origin can't be beyond that without either incredibly fortuitous luck or some kind of planning. Well, if you like luck, you can have luck.
No, chance certainly plays a role in, at some point, but even the idea that evolution depends so heavily on chance is not correct. Scientists don't believe that anymore.
Mm-hmm.
There are mechanisms that cause changes in the genetic. Yes, there's an influence of chance, but it's not an all-chance mechanism. That's a fallacy, a public fallacy that's not really understood.
And I agree with that.
Yeah.
And
I have one minute for this.
That point is valid.
Paul, did you ever read David Ron's, if when a protein molecule first comes off the slot, off the message, to find its conformation, trying out every conformation, it would take billions upon billions of years, yet it finds it in about 10 microseconds. His point is that if all conformations by chance are not allowed, if there's an energy well and it's driven by water. And for the first time, I understood that water entropy drives the instantaneous folding of the protein. That all, and he does a beautiful job of it using 1980s books with his three-dimensional, showing just a few conformations and how they're not allowed. And he says, okay, so all the 10 to the 20th power conformations aren't allowed. One is allowed. And it's driven by the energy well, and it's driven by the randomness of water. And John Nidai, who we just lost, explained to me DNA structure the same way. He said, John, it's primarily how its structure is being driven by the entropy of water. And once again, all the chance, you can't use chance arguments to explain the nature.
Well, I don't know that you'd say you can't use them, but I think you have to use them with care. Yeah.
I think that you're
almost right, and your principle is right in that there are some proteins that don't like to fold just plain in water.
Right.
And those ones actually have extra proteins called chaperones that help them to fold in the right way, because otherwise they would be millions of years still trying out combinations.
Right.
You're absolutely correct. It folds much faster than it really ought to.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that also tells us that Yaki's work and the Douglas Axis work is likely to be correct in that it takes most of those things have to be correct. If you change one, you can get by with it. If you change five, you can get by with it. Change 10, you're starting to get in dangerous territory. And if you change 100 out of 200, it's not going to fold.
So ultimately, Paul, do you think that going from the folding to God still is a quantum leap of faith? Because the theologians in this classroom know that the story you take literally is a recapitulation of a polytheistic creation myth put together by the Babylonians. And Paul, when I read it now, I used to have a big problem with it. Now that I read it metaphorically, and that's a polemic of polytheism to monotheism, all the problems, the fact that the sun gets invented, 3 days down the road, doesn't bother me anymore. Because what happens is, it's not a literal story. It was never meant to be taken literally.
Well,
does that
I disagree with you, but that's another 2-hour discussion.
All right.
Okay, Paul, you got 1 minute?
Yes. Doesn't God command the earth to bring forth life in Genesis 1?
He does.
Doesn't that imply a spontaneous foreorigin of life from the earth itself?
Well, when God does it, I don't know that you'd exactly call it spontaneous, but...
Well, I'm an evolutionary creationist, and I believe that God is responsible for creation. I believe that he's there, but there is no way that I can test any of that. Now, that's a theological position.
Yeah, and it's fair.
But I can't deny the science. Somehow, some way, that life came forth from the earth spontaneously at God's command. That's spontaneous creation.
Well, one of the things that I'm having fun with is testing the science in that particular area.
It's more like a science denial.
Well, I've gotten at least one publication out of it in secular literature, but whatever.
Okay, the next person on my list is Gary.
Thanks, Paul, for coming. I guess I'd like to say a word or two maybe in somewhat defense and relating to some of the comments that have been made. It seems to me that chance obviously is there, but you can't explain what is out there on the basis of chance alone, in my opinion. First of all, even though there is, I'm sure, and Malin's point is a good one, that there is definite evidence of kind of self-assembly amongst certain molecules in certain situations, and as John was saying, there are obvious limitations on things and molecules and forms of proteins that can be possible, but it still means that there's a huge number of proteins that are possible but would be counterproductive. And so I think that your probabilities of 10 to the power of minus 1,018 are probably wrong, but I think that to despite what has been said here, the probabilities of life happening and what we see as life just spontaneously are still minute. And it may not be 10 to the power of minus 1,000, but I think that what has been talked about here doesn't get us down into the realm of science, in the sense that if you look at an individual cell, for instance, and try and explain that without something that we don't understand a lot, at least, call it supernatural or not, then you're in trouble. It's not science, because observations don't tell us anything that explains what's there. And the other thing that's related to this is that I think that even some of the self-assembly and the kind of energy wells and that depends on natural law. And I think one of the things that, to my mind, is the most supernatural of all is the existence of laws in the universe. Where do they come from? The last point I'd like to make is that, you know, those matrices you had of looking at the different combinations of pi, or, you see, even though they're random, all those digits, if you look long enough, you'll see something that looks like a pattern, just by chance. And I would bet you that those first two matrices that you had that looked like they had patterns were taken by looking at some of the regions of those numbers of pi and say, hey, that looks interesting. It doesn't look random. It looks like there's a pattern there. But you would convince me much more if you found some region of those digits of pi that you could show me that had the due to your third one. That would be impressive. But I bet you would look for an awful long time before you found that.
Well, supposedly pi never repeats, and supposedly if you go far enough, any combination will be there.
That's right.
And so the third one could have been gotten out of pi. Now, I don't know how many places you'd have to go.
Well, that would be a very interesting
But the thing of it is, there is something special about having the first 560 be those 560. I think that hitting that by flipping coins is not going to happen. I can tell you that since I created those patterns, that one of them was done. The first one was done by flipping coins. And when I got done, I didn't look at it to see whether I had the number pi in it, and I didn't look at it to see whether I had the number e, or pi over 3, or the square root of 2, or any number of other numbers you could look at, because it just doesn't happen. I mean, it could have.
So what conclusion did you draw? I mean, that went by very quickly, and it wasn't quite clear to me what you were trying to say out of that.
Yeah, what I'm saying is that at a certain point, you draw the line, and you say the third one, for example, because it's easiest to see, was designed. And if it was a computer, the computer would look at the second one and say it looks more designed than the third one. Because the computer thinks in terms of zeros and ones and digits. Whereas the second one has, you know, kind of a little bit of order and a little bit of disorder. For our eyes, it looks like, oh, that's English letters. The chances of that happening, you can work it out, are less than 1 in 10 to the 500. 1 in 2 to 500. And that's the kind of thing. We look at it and we say, this is not chance. This is not law. This is not any combination of chance and law that's at all reasonable. This probably didn't come from a natural cause as contrasted to an intelligent cause. And you would, in fact, be right, because I know, because I did them.
Well, I agree with that to a large extent, unless there indeed is an infinite universe, but I think some of the problems you talked about there are valid considerations.
Yeah. Okay, now, the next person here, I scribbled it so quickly I can't read it, but the first letter is a B, and I'm thinking, Bear, did you raise your hand?
Oh, it was a young man over there that wanted to speak.
Bonnie, I bet. Bonnie. Yes, Bonnie.
And I have one or three.
Oh, well, you have a 3 minute.
3 minutes.
John chapter 1, which talks about in the beginning with God. Hebrews chapter 1, which also speaks about Jesus being God from the beginning. And Colossians 1, likewise. And John 14, where the doubter among Jesus' followers said, one of the doubters said, "Show us the Father." And Jesus said, "You're looking at him. Because I came to reveal the Father to you. And yes, I'm in human form, but he couldn't come in person because you wouldn't exist in his presence in your human state." I like to see science and religion blend. I do think God is the creator. Revelation 14, 6 and 7 is for our generation. Worship him who created the heavens, the earth, mountains of waters, and so forth. And that has to be pointing to the Sabbath commandment, which says, remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy because he created the same things that are mentioned in Revelation 14, 6 and 7. It's not coincidental to me that the creation evolution discussion is in our generation. And I like to read the Bible as if, with my editing background, I like to play with words. I like to take the Bible as if God is speaking to me. Of course, you have to be careful because you don't want to put words in his mouth that are not in the original. But if you read the Bible as if God is speaking personally to you and take it to heart, you see God and you know he is your ear. Just one quick example. For I so loved you, I loved you so much that I gave my only begotten Son. And if you believe in him, you won't perish, you'll have everlasting life. But to me, I get more out of reading it because though God was speaking to Jesus in human flesh, was speaking that to me, than just reading it as generically to the world. And I think we are given the liberty to do that kind of Bible reading as a way of building faith, because you don't approach God as a personal relationship through science. Science, the kinds of things you have been presenting, can help in that direction, but to approach him personally, I think we need to come as I did when I was 16, when I was an atheist, and said, "I don't believe that there is a God, but if there is a God, will you please speak to me? I'm going to spend an hour a day reading the Bible, and if you have anything to say, I'm listening. If you're there." And I started doing that with an intention of listening and being open-minded. And people. Oh, spoken in the sandstone. About 30 seconds. I'd like to just give my layman's understanding of what you were saying about the Coconino paraconformities and so on, and have you correct me so that I can understand it better. I would say that here's this geologic column that's been assembled from around the world. We fit this group of fossils here, and here's another one over here that's right above this one, and then this one over here, and this one fits in here. So you finally have this geologic column. And, well, in order for there to be all of these hybrids evolved, you have to allow so many thousands or millions of years for each layer. And when you get to the Grand Canyon, for example, you have a layer from here to here, which supposedly, in the whole geologic column, had this 60 million years missing. And here are these two on top of each other. So you have a paraconformity.
Yeah, especially if you look at it and it looks like it's a conformity. But the geologists know it can't be of true conformity because over here we have 6 million years of material.
The geologic column
that's missing.
Which somewhere says, okay, this group of fossils belongs in there, and it took 6 million years for them to evolve. So what is why was there no erosion between these two?
That's a short and dirty way of putting it, yes.
Well, unfortunately, there was.
Okay, next person on the list is Irv.
Well, thank you, Paul. As you know, I've for many decades been interested in the young earth, young life creationism literature, and you certainly represent a part of it, and much of it. As mostly in science, we only know a tiny bit of some thing, and we rely on other people for other things.
That is true.
But in your case, you take on the range of scientific disciplines to comment on.
That. You're taking on history too. Yes.
Well, yeah, you're taking on history and science and the whole thing. That does create, it seems to me, some problems. But anyway, the only thing I can really comment on is your understanding of, you didn't explain it, of accelerator mass spectrometry detecting C14. And your comment just means you don't understand the technology, that's all. But I've been working on a paper for 5 years, and I'll be happy to share it with you when it's published, explaining exactly why there's a misunderstanding of what's going on. Anyway, but that's not what I wanted to talk about. I've always been curious to get behind the specifics, because almost all your, everything, when I read you, almost everything you say is debatable, but that's okay. We all do that. But what seems to me, and I'd like to offer this as a suggestion or a hypothesis, behind all of the young earth creationist, young life creationists, are two cultural or historical assumptions or represent why these statements are made. One of them is, it took me a long time to figure out or to suggest that what your definition of science and contemporary definition of science is not the same thing. Your creationists, young earth creationists, tend to use the definition of science, a pre-20th century definition of science. It doesn't use the contemporary definitions of science, and that's a long discussion, but I just wanted to throw that out for your consideration. The other thing that strikes me as what's going on is that you make a faith statement. You believe something on the basis of some sort of faith statement, and then you attempt to use science to support it. It strikes me that that's a difficult thing to do, because the biblical narrative about creation, there's 10 different creation stories in the Torah, well, in the Bible, in the Old Testament, and you happen to like, you know, the Genesis one, and that's okay, because that's the one that's actually featured.
It's the first and biggest one.
Well, it is. It was written for the reason that was suggested before. Basically, it was an apologetic for the Sabbath, the Hebrew Sabbath, which is interesting. But anyway, I'd like your observation on the point that, let's just look at one little tiny part of the thing and what you believe about geochronology. Okay. And my question is, why are you right and 99.9% of the scientific community who does research in geochronology are wrong?
Well, that would give me pause if it weren't for the fact that the origin of life...
We're not talking about the origin of life.
No, just a minute.
Okay.
...is a stubborn problem.
Yeah.
And that... And that is one that 99% of scientists believe must have happened a certain way, But they have basically no evidence for it.
No, that's an untrue statement.
Well, it must. Maybe I should say it must not have happened a certain way.
No. You've heard of the term methodological naturalism, I suspect.
Yes, I have.
Okay.
Okay, and there are those who insist that it must be applied here rigidly, which of course
rigidly,
means...
Rigidly, by definition.
Methodologically.
By definition, right?
Which means, of course, that if that is adhered to,
mm-hmm.
If you can put it that way, no intelligence need apply.
Right. Well,
and
well, you're mixing categories, but that's okay.
Well, okay. Most of the people who work in the origin of life are convinced that there must be a naturalistic explanation.
Why do they do that?
Probably because they view all of the universe as being totally, if you can call it that, a closed system that has no...
not necessarily. They're operating as 20th century scientists. That's what, wouldn't you say that's probably the reason?
Well, see, here again, you made an assumption,
mm-hmm.
which is probably understandable from your perspective, but it's an assumption that happens to be, at least in my opinion, incorrect.
No, which is the assumption?
That is that we adhere to a 19th century definition of science. In fact, what we see is that the definition of science is fractured.
Ah, of course.
There
That's
are,
That's correct.
For example,
exactly.
There is a definition of science, and it's one you kind of learn in the textbooks early on, that it is testing hypotheses, you know, making hypotheses, testing them, or perhaps looking at data, making hypotheses
mm-hmm.
and testing them.
Mm-hmm.
It doesn't make too much difference whether you start with theory or with practice.
Mm-hmm.
Eventually, you get to the practice. You get to the hard,
mm-hmm.
you know, can you test this theory? Well, did we test it, and how did it come out?
Right.
And then if the theory fails, you modify it, or perhaps you junk it and you go after another more attractive theory.
That's right.
And there comes a point at which a theory has been worked at often enough, for example, the phlogiston theory, that finally scientists throw out their hands,
right.
and it could still theoretically be correct. You can modify it enough to account for the facts,
right.
but the modifications are so...
Precisely.
Non-organic, that most people just say, well, forget about this. That is one definition of science. There is another definition of science that said that anything that follows the rule of methodological naturalism
mm-hmm.
will work. Or that only that can be allowed is probably a better way of phrasing it.
Right,
that.
Which is, that's the assumption of 20th century science.
And
or
that's,
not the, no. the assumption of 19th century.
No.
That's why they suggested that that's the paradigm of science you're using.
And so what I'm saying is that those are two different definitions of science. And
Absolutely.
Finally, there's
Absolutely.
A third definition of science.
Oh, okay.
Which basically says that the current scientific consensus is what science really is. And you'll find people defending that.
Okay.
And so when people use the word science, I want to know, are they talking about hypothesis testing and so forth, or are they talking about you can test any hypothesis you want, but certain ones are not allowed?
No.
Or are they talking about...
The ones that don't have any physical correlates to work with are out of bounds by definition. But you don't accept that, and that's super. That's very good.
Well, here's the question.
I don't object to that assumption. Just admit
it. Okay. Supposing that science points outside of its boundaries.
Well,
there are people who insist this never happens, but if it did, then what lies in that interface? Is it science or is it not? And in fact, philosophers of science, including atheistic ones, have a terrible time figuring
Absolutely.
Out where the boundaries of science lie.
They don't have this problem. They don't have a problem with methodological naturalism at the heart of 20th century science. They don't have a problem with that.
Well,
what kind of? Give me a couple of philosophers that you're speaking of that have a problem with that.
Do you mean that would put creation as science?
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, actually,
I'm curious because
there
like
are a number
them.
Of them that
really like
there are a number of them that would say, well, creationism is actually science. It's just been disproved.
Oh, I'd like to read that. I'd like to read that.
Oh, well, I'll see if I can find the quote for you sometime.
Oh, good. No,
can I have to get four more two-minute commenters in before we close?
Thank you very much, Paul. I appreciate your comments.
I wish you had talked about carbon-14 because that's your specialty.
Well, he mentioned it in passing. He didn't understand it. So that, no,
Paul doesn't understand the technology he's complaining about. That's
yeah, but does he believe in any type of dating method?
Oh, that's an interesting question. Do you
well,
believe
actually,
in any?
I'm the one who believes in the dating of carbon-14. If you date
dinosaurs,
you get certain dates. But Irv says it's all contamination, so
no,
it's okay.
I didn't say it was all contamination. It's because you have to understand what I mean, what is meant in contamination in the literature, and I don't think you do.
Well,
that's all. That's
well,
okay.
There are testable things that can come out of this, and that. As I recall,
that's
we
right.
have worked on that in the past, and as
well,
I recall,
we
may work
future.
On that in the future.
And if you could come up with a sample that demonstrates what we've been talking about, we have something to talk about.
Yeah, there. He thinks I'm wrong. I think he's wrong. We'll see what the tests show.
Oh, okay, let's try to get the rest of the list in. Joe, you're next.
Paul, I got the impression that you were trying to bamboozle this group of Episcopalians. And by that I mean, a lot of the material that you covered was centralized into your themes, but a good scientific presentation would show sides, the other sides as well, and balance it out. And as you know, there's lots of evidence that balances. Let me give you one. See how you deal with it. The salt mines that are being worked to cover our roads, the one between Canada and Michigan is about 100 kilometers broad and 40 kilometers wide, and they take 26,000 tons of salt out each year. And they expect that this salt mine will last for 100 years or more, and they're very extensive. Now, in your flood model, how do you account for this salt mine, but others in the world that are deep as well?
Right. You have them in Louisiana. You have them in West Africa. You have them in the Mediterranean.
Salzburg,
right.
Somewhere. I mean, they're layered, nicely layered.
I've been down in the one in New Mexico.
Okay.
Yeah.
I rode the one out in Salisbury and scared the life out of me. Yeah. But from a flood model point of view, how do you account for that deposit or those deposits?
I would have to say that it's not an area that I have spent a lot of time looking at. There are strange things going on there. And I don't know that anybody has an adequate model yet.
So what are the strange things that are going on there?
Well, I'll give you one example. When I was down, we were given the standard model, and they were talking about how in this particular area, with sodium chloride that we were looking at, the WIP mine, and that they were looking at channels in the layers. And he'd point out, and here's one, and it goes down like this, kind of a semicircular, and then keeps on going across. Okay. And I looked at it, and I saw something else, and I said, well, look at it. It looks like the circle keeps right on going up around as well. And I can still remember his reaction. You know, you're right. I never saw that before. What does it mean? I have no idea, but I can tell you he has no idea, and he's a professional. There are some things going on that we just don't know yet. And I would have to say that My model is probably less fleshed out than his. He's been spending a lot more time on it. But his model has blinded him to some obvious things that once they're pointed out, they're there. I'm coming at it fresh and just looking and seeing what I see, and there it is. If you're going to ask me, do I have the answer for that? I don't. I don't know that anybody has the answer for that. And I think one of the things that should happen whenever we're talking about this, I've given you what I think. But you know, I could be wrong too. And I could be wrong in little things, I could be wrong in big things. And I've tried to do as much care as I can. And of course, this presentation, as you know, is a drive-by from, 30,000 feet looking down at the territory, not getting into the details. And I have got into some of the details, but I haven't come close to getting into all the details that one could get into. And that's one of them that I don't have an answer for. And in some cases, neither does anybody else.
Well, the geologists can tell you where those salt mines came from.
Well,
they have a reasonable theory that is testable.
Like I say, there are some features of it that nobody really understands how it works.
The features that you're talking about could be obtained by water seepage. But I'm talking about the deposit itself. They're enormous, and throughout the world, it couldn't be accounted for a single instance of the flood, Noah's flood. Impossible.
Well, like I say, you can look at it that way, and you may turn out to be right. But what should I say? That one incident is not going to make me completely change my model. I'll need a little more data before I'm ready to call it quits.
Okay, I gotta squeeze in a free. You have 1 minute, John?
Yeah, Paul. I think I was telling Bill that when I was running out to the bathroom, I don't know if I think we're closer together than we are farther apart. But along with what Dr. Willie was saying to you, how come Catholic theology, its theology was turned on its head when Copernican model came out, and it was also turned on its head again when we eliminated God from evolution, we don't need him anymore, they've been able to incorporate evolutionary theory into the theology for consistent, maybe because they've been around 2,000 years, they've had more practice at this. Why are you and why is the Adventist Church so rigid? Why can't it incorporate evolution back into its theology? Maybe the theology is really wrong.
Well, that's a possibility. The other thing is that the Catholic Church, I think, stepped too far out on the question of the centrality of the earth and the idea that the earth doesn't move, partly because of political reasons, and they got burned and they never wanted to go near that stove again. As a matter of fact, they're inching towards the stove because they're insisting that however life happened and however it evolved, and they're willing to say that it evolved, that somewhere in there a soul, which is supernatural, was put into mankind. And they're not budging on that one, because if they budge on that one, then the whole thing is gone.
Okay. Uh-oh. You just made a bad mistake.
Okay, Bill.
I'm the resident visiting Catholic, and I'm actually closer to Bonnie in her comments. We don't get deeply involved in this. I mean, science can do what it does, but our concern is with our connection to God, not the exact process by which it came. Mm-hmm. And as far as I know, the church gives pretty much freedom to Catholic scientists to go where science takes them, as does a lot of liberal Protestantism. I think it's when you get into denominations that are really strict sola scriptura that you get trapped in this. And I'm not criticizing the denomination at all for that, but this is a logical result of sola scriptura, because if you can't take Genesis exactly literally, the whole edifice is in danger, and hence your denomination has to do all of this funding of organizations like yours. You present good arguments. You're obviously very well informed. But I think ultimately this enterprise is probably doomed, but that's up to God, not... And by the doomed enterprise is to try to document the very literalness of Genesis. I don't think that's a doable enterprise, but obviously you do, and God will tell us eventually.
Well, actually, your point is an interesting one. Michael Behe and Kenneth Miller have had several debates on intelligent design. And the interesting thing of it is, Michael Behe insists, and I think he's correct, that he's driven to that by reasons which have to do with science. And the proof of the matter is that Michael Behe used to believe what Kenneth Miller still believes. God did it, but how he did it is beyond us, and if he created the universe, and then maybe he designed things where you can't really tell that there's design. And that's one of the things about design, is you can camouflage it, you know.
Why would you want to?
As I camouflage pi there, if you look at it, it looks just like the other one until I show you that it's the first 560, they're not digits, they're binets or whatever you want to call them.
You know, I have read Behe and I've read Stephen Meyer very carefully.
Yeah.
And I'm inclined to go along with intelligent design, but my faith doesn't hang on it. I don't have to have every word in Genesis to be true. If someone more like Malan turns out to be true, that's fine. God worked that way.
Well, as a matter of fact, I don't have to have every word in Genesis be true either. That may shock some of the people here, but the book Scientific Theology has sometimes been misinterpreted. It has looked at a lot of things, but the primary point of what I had written is that you can create a theology without having to buy verbal inerrancy. Or even, to a certain extent, ideational inerrancy. I actually wrote chapter 3, that's the one I deal with inspiration, revelation, and authority, first, and then I put the rest of the book around it as to, well, now that you're going to do that, what practical difference does it make? So it was chapter 3, and then chapter 1, and then chapter 4, and then chapter 2 and 5. And a lot of people look at, oh, chapter 5 has to do with radiometric dating. That's what he's really interested in. Not so. I am actually interested in what are the limits of biblical authority. And specifically, being uncomfortable with a usage of biblical authority that says that every word, every syllable has to be correct. Because I think that there are some things in there that really don't look like they're correct, and, you know, I'd be cautious about saying I know they're wrong, but I would say they sure look wrong to me, and I'm going to treat them wrong as wrong until I find a better way to explain it. So, you know, it's not actually driven by biblical inerrancy. It's driven by, does the Bible have any authority at all? And if so, where can you draw the line?
I would certainly agree with you on authority. It's just, like you say, where do you draw the line?
Okay, you know, we got to the place where I'm afraid, I'm insecure about getting these last three speakers in, Barbara, Doug, and Carl, and I'm going to...
Doug took off.
Pardon me?
Doug took off. It's that empty chair over there.
Oh, okay. Okay. So
we're down to two.
Okay, Barbara and Carl. So I'd like to make sure they get their say. Why don't we have? And I know you have your have Dave. I just feel like I'm obligated to get them in. So Barbara and then Carl, and then if you have time after that, you're welcome to it. Barbara.
Paul, I was interested in how you divided, you put science above, I mean, religion above science. I see them so different. Science, it's facts and reproducibility. I mean, in the purest sense of the word. Religion is faith, meaning, whether you're Hindu or Buddhist or Adventist, it brings meaning to my life. I see them totally different. And so, to mix them, you seem like you're always mixing this and you're trying to prove through science your religion, which they should be separate. But my question to you is on the hominid. It's now not hominid, it's hominin. And so they changed the name. But
bureaucrats. Yeah. They call a spade a manual digging implement. Okay.
No, there's a reason for it.
Oh, is there a reason for it?
There he is.
And you know, I knew nothing about it a few years ago, but I got interested. And my question to you is, you talked about the Neanderthal. We now know the genetics, so we know that we may have 2% or a certain amount. And that was in the Europeans, and of course the Africans, or they now call it the archaic humans, the Lucys and the all of these. I wanted to know, what are your feelings about these? When did they arrive? I mean, this would have to point towards some form of evolution in the pre-human and particularly the before we get to Homo sapiens or the afarensis or even the Australopithecus, afarensis, the Lucys, and all of these. And they're supposed to be, in the millions of years, these pre-human. I want to know, where do they fit into your concept? I mean, we have bones, and you know, they find more and more. It's not so easy a tree. It's more like a lot of branches. So I want your opinion on the hominids.
Well, I don't know exactly where they fit, and that may surprise you a little bit, but I have heard, we're going to talk about creationist theory now rather than the general, because, well, first of all, there's multiple general theories, and secondly, the outlines of them are kind of sort of well known, although the details vary with the theory. If you're trying to fit this into a creationist viewpoint, it appears to me that most of the stuff that's laying on the ground is Pleistocene, some Pliocene. Some of this could be flood, some of this could be pre-flood. If it is flood, it's very, very late flood stage. It'll be interesting, one of the things that would be interesting to do, although probably not permitted because there's such a scarcity of such bones, would be to carbon date it, because I think that if you're starting to get significantly what I would call post-flood dates, then it suggests that these are actually post-flood. On
some
the other
have
hand,
dated,
if they come...
Oh, they're a lot older.
Some of them,
I mean, they're in the middle.
Yeah, they wouldn't do
some
it, but
of them,
that's a fascinating idea, which has all kinds of ramifications.
The question is, how are they related to humans?
50,000 years. I mean, you can't go any further than 50,000 carbon dating.
Yeah. How are they related to modern humans? Now, there's kind of an interesting thing that's happened. And you will notice that we're 98% chimpanzee, according to the legend. And we're 2% Neanderthal, and that makes no sense.
Well, you can't simplify it like that.
Obviously, they're using...
The bonobos and the chimpanzees are the closest to
right,
us
right.
That are not human. You know, they're not Homo sapiens.
When people are throwing around those numbers, there needs to be a little more definition. I suspect that 98% is a high. From what I've seen, it's probably more like 92%. In fact, you can mathematically say that it's got to be somewhere in that neighborhood because the one genome is 12% larger than the other, and therefore they can't be identical. There has to be 12% left over somewhere. But beyond that question, there are parts of the gene that are very, very similar. If I recall correctly, chromosome 22 probably does come close to that 98%, may even exceed it, maybe 99%. On the other hand, the human Y chromosome is 30% totally different, and the parts that are similar are completely disorganized. And sometime, if you have the chance, Google the human Y chromosome and Paul Giem, and you'll get a talk on what the evidence is there, and it's rather striking. I know there's some differences, and I don't know that anybody has
bigger, whereas, and their jaws are different. I mean, there's so many.
Yeah.
That's how they grade whether what kind they are by the different anatomical. Because we only have the heart data, not the soft skin tissue.
Right. We'd love to have some soft.
But they have
don't have
categorized
it
quite
right.
Carefully, and it's.
And so
it's a complicated.
It's a tough topic because it's hard to get really good data. And I wish there were more. And I imagine that I'm not alone in that wish. It would be very interesting to see what happens to the Y chromosome when you start looking at it. Whether there's a smooth gradation between apes and humans, whether there's a chasm, and if there is a chasm, whether Australopithecus afarensis lies on the other side or on our side. If you want my frank opinion, I suspect it lies on the other side, but until we do the experiment, we'll never know.
The last, if you go to Grand Canyon and you read through how the Grand Canyon was formed, it accounts for the the nonconformity, because there's uplifts, there's inversions, there's, of course, the Grand Canyon mostly by river. But it tells you why there's some nonconformity. Have you gone in there and read all that material?
Yes, and I will have to say that I regard some of it as just so stories, and partly because you have the problem of erosion. And you have the problem of the erosion of the, for example, the 6 million year gap between the Coconino sandstone and the Hermit shale underneath it. And it sits there for millions of years. It's worse than that. There are actually cracks that go down 3, 4, 5, 6 feet, filled up with Coconino sandstone. And you're going, how do you keep this thing dry, wet for 6 million years and then crack it just in time for the Coconino sandstone to fall into it? Or how do you keep it cracked but without any dust coming into it, without, you know, and then you get the sandstone go across it. And I'm not saying that you can't find somewhere a kind of sort of, if you want to believe it, just so story, but it does seem a stretch to me.
Okay, let's get Carl in, the last of my list of three-minute comments.
Thank you for your presentation. I think one point that is quite evident this morning is that much, if not all, of the discussion concerning these various points, to a large extent, if not totally, are based upon assumptions which have not been proven. It is interesting and it takes up a couple of hours this morning to discuss these points, but it doesn't advance us very much, except for an elaborate use of the English language, sometimes to benefit our discussion, sometimes not. I'm thinking about a situation, and this has reference to the theory of intelligent design, and that is, if we're talking about intelligence design, it presupposes some degree of what we consider, and here's another assumption, a certain degree of what we consider to be intelligence. Now, that by itself is a postulate that is dependent upon our concept of reality, intelligence, etc. So, proceeding from that particular point, let's make a further assumption to fit into this discussion this morning, and that is that the Creator that we refer to loosely or specifically as God is this intelligent element. And if Descartes and other philosophers have considered the importance of such things as intelligent life, not only, but the omniscient, omnipotent, various powers that this entity has, the reality is that, as we know in our everyday life, the fact that a person has, or a dictator, or a politician, has the ability, the power to do something, does not necessarily mean that that person or entity, let's call it an entity, will pursue that particular aspect, and therefore we tend to build our theory of life and so forth around that principle, which is unproven, of course. Question then arises, basically for my question, is when we're thinking about a person or an entity such as we attribute to God, why would something of this, with reference to intelligent design, why have creation? It is it's a superfluous, meaningless concept that we attach such silly little God points to about, well, God created you and the universe in order so that you could have life and have it more abundantly or whatever, or the creation. What is the particular purpose? If you're talking about an all-powerful entity, this entity doesn't need to create. It incorporates in itself everything. So therefore, there is no absolute necessity to create. In fact, if a creation comes out of something like this, the creator might be a madman. And that is an assumption, but not necessarily disproven by our everyday contact with life and other human beings. It is a constant proof that this is a form of madness that we have. And do we attribute the madness, therefore, back to the entity called God? So why all of this discussion, which is, in effect, meaningless, to begin with? Could you give me some idea about
can you respond to that?
Well, you're asking me to read the mind of God. And
no, I'm talking about even if you started off your statement, mind of God. You're assuming, that's another assumption, that there is a God, and if there is a God, there's a mind of God, or something. There's no proof of this. And your paper, although very, very impressive in its statements, is not any proof at all. I mean, you spent a lot of time since early 1970, coming up with this, and you've written several books. But what has this produced? Could you tell me why, then, you believe in an intelligent design when there's no proof absolutely, it seems, of any intelligence. And if there is some question concerning intelligence, is our concept of what intelligence is to attribute that to the entity which has no proof?
Well, I mean, as far as that goes, we used to say that mathematics was the only place where you had proof. And then Gödel came up with his theory that says that it mathematically proves that any interesting theory of mathematics, interesting enough to contain numbers and addition, is necessarily incomplete. And that you cannot prove that it's consistent with itself. And so if one is insisting for what used to be called mathematical proof, you can't even find it in mathematics. What I am arguing for is not proof. What I'm arguing for is reasonable evidence that could be believed, and that I think is more reasonable than the alternative.
So what does that mean, really? Tell me plain English what you're talking about.
Dave, you had a woman before.
Yeah, just a 1 minute. Thank you, Paul, for your presentation. Have you had an opportunity to read the book that we're going to be reading in a few weeks called Creation in Scripture by Harold Weiss?
No, I don't think I have. I ran across the title a bit ago, but the last week or so I have been busy at other things, shall we say.
Well, the book is several years old, but I had never read it. I've heard of Weiss, and he makes reference to the chap I mentioned last week, Nick. Nick's also got a book on creation. But anyway, your focus has been on science to a large degree this morning, with the spillage over into theology, which I think a number of people here have shared is debatable. But I would suggest, in fact, if Dennis had an extra copy here, I'd buy it for you. I just happened to read it then last night in preparation for listening to your discussion and your presentation. And, you know, I think you might find it very interesting. And it really picks up on a number of points that were made by people around the table this morning, all the way from John's comment about how the scripture, you know, and the biblical writers really were culturally impacted and obviously wrote out of within their cultural environment, and he goes through that and talks the various concepts of creation that are presented in the Bible, the wisdom literature, the psalmist, the writings of Paul. I think that this could be very interesting for you to read. I'll be upfront about it. He feels that creationism is a very negative impulse, but it's scripturally based, and I would suggest you read it, and I think we'll all find the book as we read it in a few weeks and discuss it to be very interesting, particularly in the light what you said this morning. Thank you.
I'm sure that I will find it interesting.
Yeah.
I think that the more influential it is, the more interesting I will find it. I don't know whether his arguments will my opinions, but even if they don't, it will be interesting, and knows? So, you know, I may find something that he says that I can agree with that I didn't know before. So yes, I would find it very interesting.
Okay, you'll turn one minute.
What doesn't show up in this room very often is treatment of the Bible as literature. structure of story form. And Robert Alter has translated much of the Old Testament, including Genesis, with remarks. And he wants to show how the Jews were resisting the Greek notion of mythological story. And so therefore you don't find myth as the Greeks understood it in Genesis, but you do find a kind of fiction. And that argument is very interesting because he's a real pro at storytelling. That's narration is his specialty, and he's a Hebrew scholar, and he can really translate well. And I think that most of us would benefit from understanding the genre we're reading rather than mischaracterize, say, Genesis 1. It's not a Greek myth, but maybe it's not literal science or literal history, let's put it that way, either. And he has some terms he tries to keep in a little bit balanced. Of fiction with history. The Jews use fictional forms to try to tell their history. So there is a fictional element, even though it's not Greek myth.
That's one possibility, and it would be interesting to see how that fits with the data.
Well, it's not data-driven.
No,
it's meaning-driven.
Well, but it's... No, but the point of it is that there are ways that one can test whether, for example, the Exodus actually happened, whether it happened in the way it's described, when it happened in Egyptian history, or, you know, obviously if it didn't happen, then you kind of omit that kind of question. And if it happened in certain ways, then you expect certain things. If it happened, for example, the way it's described in Exodus, taking it more or less face value, you expect the Egyptian army to be wiped out at that time. Where in Egyptian history can you find that? I think it's an important question. Or can you find that in Egyptian history? And, you know, if not, it has certain implications. Maybe you'll find it in a different place than we expected. And if that happened, then maybe either Hebrew chronology is off or Egyptian chronology is off. And so I think there are all kinds of interesting things that you can do to say that if certain historical facts happened as described, then you expect certain things to come out of them. If they did, and if they, then you start getting a locking in of history. If they didn't, then either you've got the wrong history or the history is another example of fiction.
Yes, and there's nothing wrong with using your imagination to try to understand a world you don't quite understand. It's quite useful.
I mean, sometimes people think I'm defending biblical literalism. Well, first of all, as I pointed out, I'm not really. But secondly, I think that data from the, quote, real world can still push us in one direction or another. In that sense, I guess I'm pre-Galileo controversy in some ways.
Paul, do you believe in the documentary hypothesis? Do you understand that?
I understand that, and I am highly
skeptical.
Do you
go along with some of its findings? Or?
And I actually have a test for that. There is a scroll of Leviticus that I presented to the American Schools of Oriental Research, where I ended it up with saying we should do a radiocarbon test on the scroll. And, you know, if it's pre-exilic, then Leviticus is pre-exilic, including certain parts of it that nobody who's trying to rescue the documentary hypothesis will agree you're pre-exilic, in which case the documentary hypothesis is in shambles. On the other hand, if we get a test that says it's 50 BC, as one hypothesis would have it, or 100 AD, as another hypothesis would have it, well, then that theory of that particular scroll is wrong, and we're just going to have to go with something else.
Maybe it's fake theology.
It doesn't destroy the theology, but it takes off something that could support it. And I think that, as Anthony Flew put it in his younger days, theology can die the death of a single bullet, or it can die the death of a thousand qualifications.
True, true, true.
And I think if we keep backing off and backing off, eventually we don't have anything left. And that's why I think the Catholic Church decided that, nope, the soul, we're stuck with that one. And I don't care how you fight, they're going to go down to the death for that one. And
I don't see how we couldn't.
Yeah, I don't either.
I wanted to say a little bit about the next book we're going to read, Creation in Scripture. He is against creationism, but that's not the focus of the book so far as I've read. I'm presenting next week on it. What he's really looking at are every place else in Scripture where there's a lot of said implicitly or explicitly about creation, and trying to integrate that into an overall thesis about creation in Scripture, which gives you a lot more latitude in defending it, because it's a much broader concept than you just find in Genesis. And he's also a devout believer. This is not somebody coming in, you know, to pick the Bible apart.
Yeah, I actually ran into Harold Weiss when I did my master's thesis in religion. I quoted him. So.
He's a refugee from your church, and he's a great, well, I know, I think he's still officially a member, but he taught at Andrews and now in.
He's an Adventist, so he has to be right, correct?
What?
He's an Adventist, so he has to be right.
Well, of course.
That's why.
And you're an Adventist and you're right, and I'm an Adventist and I'm right. And
there.
If we disagree, we're right. Still right.
Yes. That is a very important point.
Big tent Adventist.
That's called Big Tent Adventist.
Got it here. Big tent.
Let's thank Paul for it.